In London, Saturday, September the 7th, 1940, was an idyllic late summer's day. As temperatures soared into the 90s, across the capital, people were out making the most of the unseasonably hot weather. By then, Britain had been at war with Germany for just over a year. But on that beautiful day, war was the last thing on anyone's mind. However, across the Channel, the final preparations were being made for the biggest attack against Britain since the launch of the Spanish Armada. By 4 p.m., nearly 1,000 German planes were crossing the Channel in a formation 20 miles wide, filling 800 square miles of sky. Their target? The heart of London. For those blissfully enjoying the sunshine, the war was about to hit home.
September 7th, 1940 is a date that will live with me for all time. All hell was let loose.
For over 9 hours, the people of London experienced for the first time the full terror of a concentrated bombing raid, as hundreds of tons of high explosive and incendiary bombs rained down upon their city.
The whole area was shaking. Bang, bang, bang came the bombs. We thought, oh God, will it ever stop? We were certain we were going to get killed that particular night.
Over 650 people were killed as a result of the bombing. More than 130 of them, children. But behind every statistic is a personal story of tragedy and grief that for some has lasted for 70 years.
No, I've never got over it. I never have. Never got over it. Guilt. You can live with it, but how can you forget it?
This is the story of what happened on the first day of the Blitz. By September 1940, the Battle of Britain had been raging for almost 2 months in the skies above the southeast of England. For Hitler, air superiority was vital if he was to launch his planned invasion of Britain. Up until then, the Luftwaffe's raids had been aimed at destroying the RAF, and daily attacks were targeted upon airfields and communication systems. Victory in the air was within Hitler's grasp, but on the 7th of September, he changed his tactics and took his war of terror to the people of Britain. At 4 o'clock in the afternoon, plotters at RAF Fighter Command in Bentley Priory began to record the build-up of enemy aircraft over the Channel. Within 20 minutes, the first fighter squadrons had been sent to intercept them. Tom Neal was a 19-year-old Hurricane pilot in 249 Squadron.
We climbed up 13, 14, 15, 16,000 feet over Maidstone, and suddenly, I remember, going towards a mass of anti-aircraft fire. And there, in the middle of the mass of anti-aircraft fire, were this enormous formation of German bombers. And behind them, the fighters all stepped up like flies behind. And you look at left and right of you, and there are only 12 of you, because you're only flying in a single squadron. And you think, my God, where do we start?
Tom was expecting the bombers to attack the airfields as usual. But to the horror of those back at Fighter Command, they turned instead towards London. The 7th was the day that 20-year-old Peggy Holbrow from Bermondsey had been looking forward to. She had planned a night out at the Hammersmith Palais and in the afternoon had gone shopping for a new outfit.
During that time I was there, people having fun, not thinking about a war, but despite that, something ominous happened. There was an unusual noise, and that noise brought everyone into the streets.
Control room speaking. Customers and staff will now take cover in the basement. Please do not run, but keep moving.
and we came out, leaving our purchases on the counter. The assistants came out to look up at the sky. Where was that noise coming from? And it seemed like hundreds upon hundreds of birds, of black birds. And someone said, "What are they?" Someone said, "It's the Germans." They flew right overhead and over to the docks, which was no distance away.
London's docks and the industries that line the Thames were the Luftwaffe's main target. But the river also flowed through the densely populated East End of London. And it was the EastEnders who would bear the brunt of the bombing on the first day of the Blitz. 11-year-old Tom Winter lived here, in Holyoke House in Rotherhithe, with his parents and four of his siblings.
Dear old mum, she'd gone shopping that Saturday afternoon, and she had to go to the main road, Surrey Docks. And it was whilst mum was shopping at Surrey Docks that the airway sirens went.
When you hear the warning signals, take cover at once. You may hear a siren rising and falling in pitch, or hooters sounding short blasts.
The first siren sounded at 4:43 p.m. and Tom and his siblings hurried into the large brick-built public shelter next to their flats.
And I remember as a kid, I did try to peek out. I certainly had my nose, wanted to be nosy, you know, what was happening with the Luftwaffe. And I was counting them, and men was, bloody hell, there's about 40 up there, look.
By the late summer of 1940, there had been many false alarms. So when the warning first rang out, there had seemed little reason to panic. Even as the planes flew closer, many watched in disbelief rather than head for the shelters. But as some would soon discover, the decision of when and where to take cover would have life-changing consequences. In Bethnal Green, 12-year-old Tom Betts had been out playing when the siren sounded.
Now, being a 12-and-a-half-year-old, got rather excited, and I ran to the top of the buildings that I was living in, which was about six stories high. I looked out of the roof, from the roof, and saw aeroplanes coming from the distance, 100 or more of them. And it fascinated me, just watching them coming towards me. And as I was watching, I saw them, the bombs actually falling from the aeroplanes. Not one or two, but hundreds of tiny black specks falling down. It was really frightening. It really was frightening.
Tom rushed home to find his mother. His father had recently been posted away with the RAF, leaving Tom as man of the house.
Dad said to me before he went into the Air Force, make sure Mum's okay. I was 12 and a half, so I thought I was a man, like 12 and a half. And I had to look after Mum.
Tom lived in the Victorian flats next to the Columbia Road Market. Rather than head for the public shelter below, Tom stayed with his mother in the ground floor corridor of the flats and listened as the bombs began to fall closer. 7 miles away in Lewisham, 16-year-old Derek Allen and his family were at his cousin's wedding when they first heard the sirens.
We didn't think much about it because we'd had all these false alarms and practices until in the distance we could see the docks being bombed and the fires starting and the aeroplanes droning overhead. We could see dogfights in the sky. And us boys, there was a few of us a bit around my age, we stood in the garden, absolutely enthralled. It was really exciting. After the reception, we all assembled in the garden, the whole family, to have our photographs taken. My grandfather was standing just in front of me, and my grandmother down near the front. Little did I realise then that this would be the last time that I would see him. the last time that the whole family would be together.
In the hours that followed, wave upon wave of German bombers would unleash their deadly cargo on the people of London. For those huddling together at home or in shelters, it would be a long and terrifying night. And hundreds would never live to see the morning. The Blitz on London began on the afternoon of Saturday, September the 7th, 1940, when 348 German bombers targeted the capital in the first of two raids that would last until the early hours of the morning. Hitler's decision to change tactics and bomb the people of London instead of the airfields came in retaliation for the British bombing of Berlin on August the 25th, 1940. Although the RAF's attack caused minimal damage, the German High Command was furious, and at a rally on the 4th of September, Hitler promised to raze London to the ground. By 5 p.m. on the 7th, the first bombs had begun to fall. 20-year-old Peggy Holbrow from Bermondsey had been shopping in Peckham when she saw the bombers fly overhead towards the docks.
And suddenly, bang, bang, bang. Oh, God, what are they doing? But the bombs began to make noises, dreadful noises and crashes and God knows what. And the sky turned orange. Bus came along, a 68 bus, and it took me to Bermondsey. And there, mother and father were there. We said, oh dear, what is happening? He said, they bombed the docks. And black clouds of smoke appeared in the sky.
By 5:30 p.m., London's Docklands were a blazing inferno. The terrible scenes captured in this remarkable film, shot by cameramen from the London Fire Brigade film unit. As the cameras rolled, huge clouds of black smoke billowed into the air from burning oil storage tanks, and fires raged uncontrollably in woodyards and warehouses along the Thames. Among the fire crews that raced to the East End to tackle the inferno was 17-year-old junior fireman Richard Holsgrove. His team was sent to the Surrey Docks in Rotherhithe, where 200 acres of timber were burning out of control.
Now, the term was the bells go down. And when the bells went down, we jumped into our boots and fire gear, run out to the fire engines, and off we went to Surrey Docks. And when we got there, of course, I first had my first sight of what the fire was really like.
This was the scene that greeted him.
There was wood burning, flames going up in there and everything. And I suppose inside, I can't be said it was frightened, but excitement as a young boy. I was more hoping that this fire be put out very quick so I could get home and tell my mum. You know, it's all right. That was the feeling I had.
The fires at Surrey Docks became the biggest Britain had ever known. 1,000 pumps were used to try to control them, and firefighters from as far away as Brighton, Birmingham, and Bristol were called in to help. With little previous experience, Richard Holsgrove was grateful to receive advice from one of his senior officers.
He sort of helped me by saying, it's all right, lad, don't worry, you just stand by me, but just hold on to the hose and whatever you do, don't let it go. Because you had something like about 40 to 60 pounds of pressure coming through that nozzle. And if you was to let that go, the hose would have been like a serpent. And if it hit you, it could kill you.
Sandwiched between the burning timber yards at Surrey Docks and the River Thames, Tom Winter and his brothers and sisters were in danger of becoming trapped in the shelter below the flats where they lived.
We were in that shelter for something like an hour. And now it was getting really, really uncomfortable because we started seeing smoke as well. It was like looking out into a fog, and yet this was a September evening. And talk amongst the air raid wardens and the adults, men, I think we'll have to evacuate the shelter because the flats that we lived in, which was just adjacent to the shelter, they were going up in flames. And I always remember as we run through the square, a little exodus of people, the church wall, a brick wall that ran something like 200 yards, seemed to be moving. It might have been moving with the heat. The heat was terrific, absolutely terrific. Firemen that was trying to help our escape were actually firing their hoses against the wall of the church to give an avalanche of, like a cavern of water, a tunnel of water for us to run through to escape the smoke and the flames.
Over 20 firefighters were killed as firestorms erupted and buildings collapsed. But countless lives were saved by their courageous actions on that day. At Surrey Docks, Richard Holsgrove's senior officer thought he heard someone calling for help.
And he says, there's someone up there, there's someone up that building. I couldn't see anybody at the time, but next thing we do was, might have been a chair or something come through the glass when they just smashed it, and then kept shouting out help. It was three stories on there. We used what they call a hook ladder. And we used to hook it on the window ledge above us, climb up, put our legs over the window ledge, then lift the other ladder up, hook it over the next one. That's what we used. And he said to me, can you do that? Because I can't let go of the hose. I said, yeah, I'll do it.
Despite his inexperience and the fact that the building might collapse at any moment, Richard climbed to the top and pulled the terrified man from the flames.
He got over, I got behind him and helped him because he was all shaking. And we climbed down the ladder to the next windowsill. I said, now put your legs over the windowsill. I'll hold you, don't worry. And I'd done the same, unhooked the ladder, went down to the next floor till we got down the bottom and then helped the chap down. But we had to treat him because he was so shaken. He was trembling, he was shaking all over. But that was the life saved that I felt very proud of.
At 6:10 p.m., an hour after the first bombs had fallen, the all clear sounded. And across the East End, local residents emerged from their shelters to a scene of total devastation. From the worst hit areas, there was a mass exodus of people, and many made for London's West End or further afield to the Essex countryside. But for some of those who had escaped the bombing, it was time to keep calm and carry on.
After about an hour and a half, 2 hours, the all clear went. When we came out and looked around us, we could see the fires from the docks from where we were. My mother said, right, quite calmly, we'll have to go and get the shopping now for the weekend. Sounds stupid now, but shopping had to be done. We did the shopping. And I even remember buying my comic books, Superman, I think it was at the time. And on the way home, I was looking forward to reading comics and having a normal Saturday.
However, this was just the lull before the storm. As darkness fell, another vast formation of bombers was heading towards London. And this time, they had civilian targets in their sights. At 8:10 p.m., 2 hours after the all clear, the siren sounded again. This time, Tom Betts insisted that rather than stay in their flats, he should take his mother to the official public shelter under the Columbia Road Market.
I said, Mum, we ought to go to the shelter. And she said, well, aren't we going in the corridor? And I said, well, there's an official shelter, Mum, the ARP shelter. That is a proper depot, and it's an official one, so let's go there. And in my wisdom, I thought that was the wisest thing to do because my father had told me to look after Mum as the oldest boy. My mother said, okay, we'll go down, Tom. And I was pleased that she accepted and we went down into that shelter. Pleased about it because I felt this was a safe haven. We wouldn't have any trouble down there.
But in the hours that followed, over 300 tons of high explosive and incendiary bombs would fall on London, killing and injuring those below randomly. In Lewisham, 16-year-old Derek Allen had been enjoying his cousin's wedding reception. His father had left early to drive Derek's grandparents to their house here in Blessington Road. When the party ended, Derek made his own way home.
When I got home, there was a terrible atmosphere. People were up, they weren't in bed, which I expected them to be. And I said, what's wrong? And my father said, my two best friends have been killed. And I immediately thought of two army people because he'd just been discharged from the army with wounds. But it wasn't. It was his parents, my grandmother and grandfather. Their house had taken a direct hit. In those days, it was always said, big boys don't cry. And although I felt like crying, I just couldn't in front of my parents. So I made an excuse, went into the toilet, locked myself in and really sobbed because we were a really close family and I loved my grandparents.
The loss of his grandparents would change Derek's life forever. And there would be many more family tragedies to follow that night. But from the flames would rise a defiance and determination that would help Britain win the war. At 8:10 on the evening of Saturday, September the 7th, 1940, the air raid siren sounded for the second time across London, as over 300 German bombers flew towards the capital. That afternoon, despite the best efforts of the Royal Air Force, London's Docklands and the East End had been devastated. Over 60 German planes had been shot down, but the RAF had lost over 30 fighters and 15 pilots had been killed. 19-year-old Hurricane pilot Tom Neal flew four times that day. After shooting down a Messerschmitt 109, he returned to his base at North Weald, exhausted.
If you're very hotly pursued by the enemy and you've escaped and, you've escaped with your life, you feel like a piece of chewed string. And you get back and you're worn. You flop on your bed and you sleep.
Tom recorded some of what happened that day in his logbook.
We lost half the squadron. Boost Fleming killed. Wells, Killingback, Smithson, Grandy, Barton, Crossy, all shot down. And then I've put, I was very, very scared. That is absolute nonsense, of course. I was never scared, but anyway. It also finishes, results negligible.
The bombers that returned to attack the capital that evening came without their usual fighter escort. But as the RAF had been stretched to the limit, there were no night fighter squadrons available to engage them. The Luftwaffe was free to bomb London with impunity. Back on the ground, 11-year-old Tom Winter and his siblings, whose mother was trapped in a shelter in Rotherhithe, were making their way through the burning docks towards a rescue centre that had been set up at Keaton's Road School in Bermondsey. On their way, they were spotted by their neighbour, Mrs. Elliot.
And Mrs. Elliot said, Joey, Tommy, come over here, bring your sisters. You're not going to go to the school. You're coming to my sisters. Your mum would never forgive me if I let you, go off into the night to a rest centre. And Mrs. Elliot took us, headed towards her sisters. We never got time to reach our sisters. The second air raid was just starting. The sirens went, and police, ARP wardens, come on, off the street, and they took us under the railway arch in Southwark Park Road.
Meanwhile, just a mile away at Alscott Road in Bermondsey, 20-year-old Peggy Holbrow and her family were sitting in an Anderson shelter in the cellar of their home, experiencing for the first time the true terror of a bombing raid.
The whole area was shaking, shaking. Bang, bang, bang came the bombs. And it was so frightening. My sisters and I, we all covered ourselves over, one on top of the other, putting coats over our heads to try and deafen the noise of the bombs. It went on and on. We thought, oh God, will it ever stop? We were certain we were going to get killed that particular night.
While those in the East End feared for their lives, this is how a BBC reporter described the scene, viewed from a rooftop across the city.
I'm standing on top of a very tall building, from where I can see practically the whole of London spread round me. And if this weren't so appalling, I think it would be one of the most wonderful sights I've ever seen. The whole of the skyline to the south is lit up with a ruddy glow, almost like a sunrise or a sunset.
With bombs continuing to fall all around them, Tom Winter and his siblings sheltered under the railway arch on Southwark Park Road.
And it was whilst we was under there, this was now about 10 o'clock, we could hear the guns and the bombs raining down on Bermondsey. It just went on and on and on. And about 20 minutes later, there was an almighty whistle and this rushing noise. It was very close. We heard the bang, and it was only about 20 minutes later that news was sifting in that Keaton's Road School had got a direct hit.
If it hadn't been for the chance intervention of their neighbour, Tom Winter and his brothers and sisters would have been here when the bomb exploded. At least 38 people lost their lives as a result of the Keaton's Road school bombing. Almost half of them were children. In some cases, whole families died together. One man, Charles Thomas Brown, lost his wife and seven children. And Sidney Arthur Bond, who was a good friend of Tom Winter's father, lost his wife and four children.
Arthur Bond, he was a lovely man. And on the Sunday, I'm told by Dad that Mr. Bond was walking through Bermondsey. He was like a madman. He just couldn't come to terms with it.
As the night went on, tragedies like this one were sadly all too common as bombs continued to fall across the city. And death or serious injury could happen indiscriminately. In Bethnal Green, 17-year-old Ellen Neaport and her fiancé, George Ackrod, were in the official public shelter below the Columbia Road Market. With them were Ellen's father and her four younger brothers and sisters, seen here in this photograph, taken just weeks before.
Derek was three, and Samuel was five, and Josie was 13, and Irene was 15. The children was staying there with a friend of my mum's who had four children, and she said, I'll find you a place with the air, because Mum, I don't want my children sleeping where there's a lot of old people. My mum was very fussy. And she said, now I'll find you a nice place where the air comes in. And afterwards we found out that that was where the bomb fell, down the air shaft where they was lying.
Shortly after midnight, one of the high explosive bombs that fell that night plummeted straight through a narrow glass ventilation shaft that provided air to those in the shelter below, and then exploded. There were around 1,000 people in the Columbia Road Market shelter that night. Among them were 12-year-old Tom Betts and his mother. Tom had been sleeping when the bomb exploded.
And when I opened my eyes, I was giddy, and it was black, lots of dust. People, I could hear people moving and running and pushing all over the place. And it was very dark, and I felt around me, and I couldn't feel anything but bricks and dust and debris. And as I was crawling along, I went past a woman, and she said to me, "I don't want any blood on my blanket," she said. And I thought, what does she mean, blood? And what I thought was perspiration on me, wasn't it? It was blood running down the whole of my left side. And I was obviously very conscious of the fact that I'd been hurt.
In the explosion, a fragment of shrapnel had passed straight through Tom's skull. He was lucky to be alive, but in the chaos and confusion, had no idea what had happened to his mother. Ellen Nieport and her fiancé George Ackford had left the shelter to go home just seconds before the bomb exploded inside. George immediately rushed back in and, together with Ellen's father, began to search desperately for her younger brothers and sisters.
One of the worst things was digging and digging and digging all this debris. It was loaded up with the bomb exploded. All these iron sheets was on top. And you're wondering, will I ever find them? That was on your mind. Will I ever find them?
It was such a bang, and I know Jill said to me, "You stay here, and I'll go in and see what's happening in there." So George went, and I was sitting on this bench like seat. And while I was sitting there, I'll never forget it, there was a lady, she was a big built lady, and she had a baby dead, you know, all its. And it's never had hardly any head, and she had it in her arms, like having it like this.
Me and her dad, we got the two boys out, and they had been killed outright. So you can imagine the shock we was in. We looked around for Renee and Joycey, found Renee, and we got some people to carry her out. She was in a terrible condition, all her stomach had been blown away. And we was looking for Joycey. We couldn't find Joycey. Someone else had taken her out.
Despite the best efforts of George and Ellen's father, all four of her brothers and sisters died.
My dad told my mum what had happened. And the screams, you know, my mum, I often used to, you know, hear it and wake up and hear it. She screamed and screamed and screamed and screamed.
Now, I remember her dad, he was crying, and I never heard a man cry like it. I was crying, but I was trying to comfort him, but didn't know what to say. How could I comfort the man? He'd just lost four children.
Life was never the same after that, really. Well, you learn to live with it. Didn't know how to laugh for a long while. Well, people just say to me, "Had you got a miserable face?" I get annoyed and I say, "I had the smile locked off of my face when I was 17.
Along with the Nieport children, over 40 people were killed in the Columbia Road Market shelter bombing, making it the worst civilian tragedy of the night. It would be 4:30 a.m. before the all clear finally sounded. And with the dawn came the realization that life in wartime Britain would never be the same again. It was 4:30 a.m. on the morning of the 8th of September 1940 when the sirens finally sounded the all clear across London. and thousands emerge from their shelters to find their home in ruins. For many of those who survived the horror of that first night, it was difficult to come to terms with what had happened.
To think that they were coming over and bombarding us, our town, our London. That destroyed me, to think they could do it to us.
Later that morning, Prime Minister Winston Churchill, who had been at Chequers, his country retreat throughout the bombing, made a personal visit to the East End to see the devastation for himself.
These cruel, wanton, indiscriminate bombings of London are, of course, a part of Hitler's invasion plan. Little did he know the spirit of the British nation or the tough fibre of the Londoner.
Churchill's words were an inspiration to some of those who had lived through the bombing. Out of the dust and rubble grew the grit and determination to keep going that became known as the Blitz spirit. In Lewisham, Derek Allen's grandparents had been killed just hours after Derek's father had driven them home following this family wedding.
Life, of course, completely changed from that day onwards. But to see my father absolutely change overnight was incredible. The shock of his parents being killed and the fact that he'd taken them home, I suppose, he must have felt, if only I hadn't taken them home, they would have been all right.
After the death of his parents, Derek's father was grief-stricken and never worked again. So at the age of 16, Derek took over the running of the family removals business, which had been set up by his grandfather many years before.
So this business that my grandfather started in 1918 and had then been carried on by my father was now in my hands. And we were very, very busy because people that had been bombed out had to have their furniture moved. And quite often we had to go into buildings that were falling masonry and unexploded bombs sometimes. But it just became part of everyday life. So from being a boy, I suddenly had to become a man, running a business and doing a man's job.
It wasn't until almost 11 a.m. on the 8th of September that Tom Winter and his siblings were reunited with their mother. She had spent the night trapped in a shelter in Rotherhithe, terrified that her children might have been killed.
My mum was, can you say, hysterical with happiness, because that's what she was, absolutely overjoyed to see us and arms around each and every one of us. It was a lovely moment.
Tom and his siblings might well have been killed that night if their neighbour, Mrs. Elliot, hadn't stopped them going to Keaton's Road School, where so many died. The life-changing moment when she called out to them on the street is captured in this picture, painted by Tom, that he calls a shout from the night.
A shout from the night, come on you winter kids, and that saved our lives. And I try to capture that moment in the picture when we're seeing her beckoning us across the road. And if you look at the picture that I've painted, you can see us four kids just leaving this, you know, procession of people. There is no doubt that the people you see in that picture walking along Southwark Park Road in their hundreds, probably many of them became some of the fatalities at Keaton's Road School.
Now National newspaper reports of the bombing estimated that the number of people killed was around 400. In fact, the true number is over 650. Amongst the greatest tragedies of the night was the bombing of the Columbia Road market shelter in Bethnal Green, where over 40 people were killed. This was where 12-year-old Tom Betts had taken his mother that night. After the explosion, Tom was rushed to hospital with severe head injuries. 10 days later, he still had no idea what had happened to his mum. Until his father, who had got special leave from the RAF, came to see him.
I asked him, I said, you know, where's mum, Dad? How's mum? Because I honestly thought perhaps she was all right and had gone home, you know, with him. I didn't know. And he said, she's dead. And it sounded so cold. He didn't mean it. I'm sure he didn't mean it to hurt me that way. Oh, but boy, it stabbed me. And that really did, it brought the worst out in me. It was a real feeling of pang, of anguish. It was awful. I felt in that sort of stab, I'd taken Mum down to that wretched shelter and she'd been killed. And in some ways, I feel like I killed my mother. It's awful, but I did. Had we not gone down there, it wouldn't have happened. Those things have all gone over in my mind, over, repeatedly, over and over again, over the years and years that it's happened. 70 years ago.
Hitler's decision to bomb London was a turning point in the war. Had he continued to attack the airfields, victory in the Battle of Britain might well have been his. But with the airfields given time to recover, victory went to the RAF. And without air superiority, Hitler was forced to cancel his planned invasion indefinitely. The Blitz on London, however, continued like this night after night until May 1941, and the Luftwaffe's aerial attacks spread the length and breadth of Britain. By the end of the war, 60,000 people would be killed in stories like these as a result of the bombing. However, it was the Blitz spirit, born on the night of the 7th of September 1940, that helped the people of Britain to carry on regardless, and eventually to win the war.
They came, they bombed us. They hoped that it would finish us off. But we were the British. We had the spirit. It's like Churchill said, we will fight to the end, and we did. We really did.